So we want to interview you and we want a brain sample or a sample of your brain tissue. And he's like, sure, anything. Rick Moranis is great. He was he's a great substitute for what they thought was going to be John Candy. And I even like the part where every time he steps out of his apartment to talk to Dana, or even where he's like outside of the apartment when Murray leaves after he goes to the apartment to check it out that first time. Every time he tries going back into his apartment, the door is locked. You can't get back in. He's always like in the hallway, all awkward. But they save the city. There's a great little montage at the end of, you know, them coming out of the building and the crowd just, you know, cheering and chanting for them. And that's the end of the movie. Like I said, the movie moves pretty quickly. So the title Ghostbusters was what the script was called. Unfortunately, there was a 70s TV show, like a kid's TV show, called The Ghostbusters. And it was like these two guys and a gorilla that were like chasing ghosts. And Columbia Pictures wanted that title, but they had to get the rights for the title from this TV series, or from whoever owned it, which was Filmation. That was the same. They did the He-Man cartoon, but they were owned by Universal. And they were trying to get the rights to it and weren't sure if they were going to. And they even were like starting to shoot and were kind of doing two takes of every, or alternate takes of everything, where they had, you know, they would use the Ghostbusters title or the Ghostbusters name, and then they would go back, reshoot the scene, and use Ghost Breakers, which I think was the title, the temporary title that they had, in case they could not get the rights to Ghostbusters.
Mm-hmm.
So they were using Ghost Breakers, but it became very tedious. They were wasting a lot of money doing that. They had so little time that it was hard for them to do. Even with the turnaround time on the film, like, even Reitman wasn't able to do more than a few takes of each scene. So, like, you know, everything had to work. And they're lucky that they have, you know, some professional people and, you know, some good improv work, some good ad-libs, that a lot of those scenes were able to work with just, you know, the one or two takes. But it's getting expensive and it's getting tedious reshooting everything with Ghost Breakers because they're not sure if they can get the Ghostbusters title. So eventually, like, the producers just said, you know what? Stick with Ghostbusters. You know, just stick with that. We're going to do everything we can. Hopefully we'll get the rights. But right now, assume that we will just use Ghostbusters. And Filmation or whatever it is, and Universal did not want to give up the rights to the name. What happened was, the guy that was running Columbia that approved Ghostbusters had a falling out with the owners of Columbia Pictures. Coca-Cola ended up owning Columbia Pictures for a time in the 80s, and this guy, Frank Price, the guy that approved Ghostbusters, did not get along with them. So he parted ways with Columbia, got a call from Universal Pictures to run, you know, that studio. He ended up at Universal. And then he said, okay, we're going to make a deal with Columbia to use the Ghostbusters so that they can use the Ghostbusters name. So he made a deal. Negotiated the Ghostbusters rights so that they could use the title. And from what I understand, Columbia Pictures had to pay $500,000 and promise Universal like a 1% share,
yep,
of the film's profits in order to use the title. which I think Universal got the $500,000, but according to Wikipedia, I don't think that they got the 1% share of the profits.
That it wasn't, it didn't make enough for them to get anything or something like that, right?
Yeah, I think that was the claim, even though it was, you know, a huge, huge hit. They have the film wrapped. They got the Ghostbusters name. They were trying really hard to hit this deadline. I mean, they had June was the deadline. They finished shooting in, I think, late January. And then a lot of the effects work had still to be done. Edlin and his people were working on all that. Edlin, I told you Edlin came out of the Lucasfilm and worked on Star Wars. Did I tell you the other movies that he's worked on?
No.
We've talked about a few of them before. He worked on Raiders of the Lost Ark. He worked on Poltergeist, both for ILM. He, after he did Ghostbusters, which was his first on his own, did Big Trouble in Little China. He did Die Hard. He did The Hunt for Red October. So he worked on like a ton of really big movies throughout the 80s. So they're working on the effects. But while that's being worked on, you know, Reitman and Columbia, they have to kind of figure out how the movie is going to do. You know, they have to gauge it, so they show it for a test audience. And because it was so fresh that some stuff wasn't done, they screen it for a test audience with like some of the effect stuff is missing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can see wires, and you can see a lot of the stuff that's not supposed to be there. But sometimes that's how they go with test screenings, where, you know, some stuff isn't done. But even when they're missing stuff, and they say, you know, scene missing or special effect shot, whatever, even with all that, the audience still went nuts for the movie. They either didn't notice that stuff or just didn't care because the movie around it was so good. Which is funny because they all loved it. But like the executives at Columbia in the industry, like, all thought, oh man, this is awful. we're gonna lose a ton of money on this. Which sometimes goes to show you, I think I've mentioned it before, don't trust the studio people. They wanna tailor everything specifically to make the most money, but instead you lose that creativeness to everything.
Mm-hmm.
So everything gets done. They have everything edited. They have all the effects done. And I think they finished it just like a couple of weeks before it was supposed to open. So they were really pushing the time.
I think this was also inducted into the National Film Registry, right?
Yep.
Yep.
Yep, it's in the film registry. Movie opens June 8th, 1984, the date that was set upon, or that was agreed upon by Reitman and Frank Price, you know, like the year prior. Do you know what other movie opens up that day? I'll give you a hint. It's the second movie that summer that leads to the advent of the PG-13 rating.
Was it Gremlins?
It is Gremlins.
Ah.
So, I told you when we were talking way back when about horror movies, when you and James and I did that episode. In 1982, on the same day, June 25th, 1982, two classic movies open up. Both bombed. And both are... One is a horror classic, one is a horror sci-fi classic. Or no, not a horror sci-fi. One is a sci-fi classic, one is a horror sci-fi classic.
Okay.
The Thing and Blade Runner both open up on the same day. And now, in 1984, on June 8th, you have both Ghostbusters and Gremlins opening up on the exact same day. Unlike The Thing and Blade Runner, both of these were actually huge hits. But just, can you imagine, like, how often does that happen these days?
No, very often. Not like that. That's insane that they opened up against each other. Wow.
Yeah, and they both made almost the same amount of money on their opening weekend. On the opening weekend, Ghostbusters makes $13.6 million.
Uh-huh.
Gremlins makes just a million underneath. Like, they both open up to, that's a lot of money in 1984.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big hit. But nowadays what happens is you have a big movie opening up on some day, and kind of all the other studios kind of avoid that day.
Yeah, they're scared.
Because
right?
They know that...
Yeah,
they're scared. But, you know, back in the day, it was, we're going to open up, you know, these movies all against each other, probably because they didn't think that they were going to do well, or, you know, they weren't tracking that well, or they just weren't intimidated.
That's interesting that they would open Gremlins, and I knew this beforehand, but to open a, you know, what is essentially an unorthodox Christmas movie in the summertime.
Yes.
Pretty bizarre. But I mean, they still made the money, so.
Yeah. It's weird. It's weird that they didn't release that, you know, towards the holidays. Even though it's not really a holiday movie. You know, it's... I don't know if I would say Gremlins is a horror movie, but...
It teeters that line, you know?
Yeah. But it's nuts that both those movies opened up against each other. And even the other big movie that weekend that wasn't opening but had been out for 2 or 3 weeks at that point in time is still Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, which makes, I think, about $12 million as well. So all three of those movies were, you know, within about $1 million or $1.5 million of each other that opening weekend. You know, it does huge business. It opens up huge. It gets pretty good reviews. And it's a huge hit, man. It's number one at the box office for 7 weeks in a row. It's number one until, I think, late July, 7 weeks after it opens, and gets usurped by Purple Rain, which opens up to number one. Early August. That's 7 weeks. Early August is when Purple Rain opens up. But immediately, the next week after, Ghostbusters goes back to number one. But it only stays at number one for a week. Red Dawn opens up. That goes to number one. Tightrope, which I think is a Clint Eastwood movie, is number one for a little while. But then Ghostbusters gets the number one spot again in about mid-September. So it had legs. It was around for, you know, 3-4 months. Still doing huge business. In the end, Ghostbusters remains in the top three films at the box office for 16 weeks. 16 straight weeks. It finally drops out of the top 10 in October of 1984. So it had huge staying power. I think it ends its theatrical run domestically at $229 million. It's the number one movie of the year at that point in time. It's the highest grossing comedy of all time at that point in time. We obviously, Beverly Hills Cop comes out towards Christmas.